16, they often buy a moped as a form of first transport, one up from the push bike. And then when they turn 17, they upgrade to a motorbike of 125 capacity. Now this here is a 2008 CG Honda 125. And this is the very, very typical motorbike of what people riding small capacity will be riding as a first motorbike, for example. And it makes me think, with today's laws so strict on what you can ride at a certain age or how long you've had your license, going back in time, everything comes a bit less strict. So in the 1950s, you could be quite young and ride a very powerful motorbike. But were there motorbikes in the 1950s of low capacity power? What would the equivalent of this motorbike be in the 1950s?
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, you're crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time.
Now, if you haven't recognised this bike already, this is the BSA Bantam D1. Now, these were first made in 1948. And they stopped making them in 1971, but over that period of time, the models did change, all within BSA Bantam. But the D1 was the first version to come out, and this particular model is from 1955. There are a few subtle changes between the 1940 ones up to 1955. Now this one has three gears, it's one down and two up, which is quite rare to have a 125 with that fewer gears. It has a 4.5 brake horsepower engine and it's a two-stroke. So you mix the two-stroke oil in with the petrol, so it's a bit difficult when you come to a petrol station because you have to get all these measurements right, and it can be crucial if you get the measurement too strong or particularly too weak. It has a rough top speed of about 50 miles an hour, and that's if you're lucky. I mean, going at a slight downhill with the wind behind your back, and also depends how much lunch you've had.
The BSA Bantam holds a hidden secret, as this bike was not completely designed by the British. During the Second World War, the Germans made a lightweight motorcycle called the DKW RT125. This was copied by the British and we made the BSA Bantam. This was not widely known until the Bantam's fame, as it is still considered a lightweight British motorcycle. The DKW was copied by both the British and the Americans. Over the States, Harley-Davidson made a 125cc, but it wasn't so successful. And over here, very successful, we made the BSA Bantam. We changed all the measurements into Imperial, just to make it that bit more British. In October 1948, the BSA Bantam was released onto British roads, with telescopic forks, a rigid rear end, direct electrics, shovel front mudguard, and a fishtail silencer. The D1s were made in mist green for £60 plus their VAT. Over the time, the shape changed, better suspension, things like that. And the engine capacity changed from 125 to 175cc. The D1 started in 1948 and ended in 1957. Then it went to the D3, the D5, the D7, the D10, and finally the D14, which ended in 1971. And that's when the Bantam, famous British bike, finally went down.
Hey, get a rhythm. When you get the blues, come on and get a rhythm. When you get the blues, get a rock and roll feeling in your bones.
When you're actually riding this bike, you sort of think when the suspension is quite poor, the acceleration is slow, and the brakes are very vague.
Overall, I've described this bike as absolutely fantastic, and I would recommend it to anyone who likes something a bit unique, a bit classic, and it's also a fantastic way to learn about very basic engines on motorbikes. They are so simple and you really learn a lot from them. And best of all, they're really good fun. Plus, it even has a horn.
Get a rhythm. When you get the blues, get feeling in your bones, get taps on your toes, and get gone, get a rhythm. When you get the blues. Well, I sat down and listened to the shoeshine boy, and I thought I was gonna jump for joy. Slapped on the shoe polish left and right, he took a shoeshine rag and he held it tight. He stopped once to wipe the sweat away. I said, you're mighty little boy to be working that away. He said, I like it with a big